being in a position wherein he was expected to say something, one man offered the following. The supreme evidence of the power of mechanicalness is in the fact that men can be shown that they live in such conditions and it affects them not. End of offering. Scientific elaboration, sui generis et supra so. Life's homeostasis is unique in that it has no external environment in relationship to which to adjust. There was once a boy who would sing, "Take me home, country road," until his travels revealed to him that he was the road and that his home was simply where he had always been. Thinking assumes its vaulted position by thinking about things. By thinking about things not achieved and destinations not reached as though they are. More than the model for the motto, "You can't keep a good thing down," nay, the exemplar of the certitude that the necessary can never be negated. I just want you people to know that I'm not making this shit up. The ordinary look for mysteries without. The few know where they really reside. To them, the difference between astronauts and spelunkers is a man whose main concerns are still his actions and his words has yet to reach a useful plateau. There is a stable, self-righting structure into which we are all born, the physical universe. There is also a similar internal one into which we are born, and within which we normally live our days and die with no substantial change occurring in between. Ordinary sight is loath to reveal where you are if where you are is part of what you are. Planets with life become such through travel by reflective devices. There is nothing more stable and self-correcting than mirror images of mirror images of mirror images. There is no description more accurate of the inner explorer than that of the mold breaker, the chemical shaker. In a case of an old saw with a new blade, one man thought, what better example of a gross exaggeration than the reports of my being alive? Mark that one. Noise. A man deep in the struggle for that clear state of mind goes through several stages regarding the matter of noise. At first, it doesn't particularly bother him. Then it does. Then later. Much, much later, it again ceases to. Question, can you figure out exactly what is meant here by the word noise? The mathematics of it. If consciousness is composed of thinking and knowing, and you subtract thinking from the equation, look what you've got left. Regarding the proposal that some things are naturally offensive, only certain uncontrollable ones are so to the few. Certain internal, individual, uncontrollable ones. To a more alert man, if it is automatic and it is in him, it is insulting and degrading. And not in relationship to any external standard. Somewhere along his journey, one man mused, I may not have yet reached my destination, but on the other hand, I am surprised and pleased that at least I haven't killed myself through my own well-known stupidity. Proverb extension in service to the exposition concerning the dynamics of the desiring man to help others. That's the heading. Give a man food and he'll eat today. But teach him how to fish and he'll eventually stuff on a hook and blame you. Sailing, a poem. We sail on a sea of chemistry, to and fro, to and fro. We sail on a sea of chemistry, here and there, here and there. We sail on a sea of chemistry, in and out, in and out. We sail on a sea of chemistry, to and fro, here and there, in and out. Apparently. Thinking undoubtedly produces change in the external world, but the belief that it does so internally is a dream. Inasmuch as idiocy is not so frightening from afar, one man suggests that we keep our distance. If you get it, move up two places and roll again. When one man heard the description of someone slipping in and out of consciousness, he was greatly taken thereby, but then was deeply disappointed to learn that it was only applied to the physically injured. I didn't know I was ringing this in an emergency. Another choice opportunity missed, he mused. And to himself, one man declared and admitted, no doubt about it, thinking has reached astronomical proportions. And I would be even more impressed by it were it not for the fact that it is thinking that is responsible for me noting this. All in all, a caravan whose only end is its front rank refreshing its rear. After a certain place in this extraordinary endeavor, a man has no more knowledge of the external world. No theories, no notions, no ideas, nothing. It's just there. After a certain place, he also loses all concern in any philosophy of man, especially regarding himself internally. His only interest in that area is in finding an operations manual. The law of consequence. If you think, you'll be confused. Let me note to the audience that it's useless to stick around in hopes of more. That's it. That's the law. So reflected one chap, if, as the ordinary like to say, there is magic in words, then somewhere within silence must reside wizardry of an astounding nature. Even as positive changes would take place in him, one man, the older he got and the more he understood, the less inclined he was to take full credit therefore. After all, he reasoned, if death is the ultimate awakening, whose fate is in whose hands? One man mused that the true state of consciousness would be like a forgetfulness that never forgets itself. Or like a state of forgetfulness that even forgets itself. Another poem. On certain drugs, you need no hugs. The preceding was brought to you through the combined efforts of herd emotions and brain chemistry, who are not responsible for how you may take it. One man sadly notes, it accomplishes naught to hear my normal state of consciousness assailed, for when I am therein, I lack sufficient awareness thereof to judge the validity of the critique. I agree. A man sadly notes, well, it's worth a repeat, it accomplishes naught to hear my normal state of consciousness assailed, for when I am therein, I lack sufficient awareness thereof to judge the validity of the critique. A traveler on a search whose only hope for success occurs when he's not there. Another sighting taken on thinking versus knowing. Thinking is always in relationship to something else. Knowing is not. a pirouette around the possibilities. To care what you are helps keep you from becoming your true self. Attempting to explain the present conditions of his progress, one man said, "I have been faced with industrial strength stupidity." He did not, however, point to the direction in which this lay. Part 2. Roads do not naturally occur, but appear only where men walk. And men walk only where life requires roads for them to travel. One man pictured the automatic flow of thought in him as a form of unattended head lice. Another state of consciousness is to be had by merely peeling oneself from oneself. In one land, if you win the lottery, you're beaten slowly to death by teeny little incessant blows from merely and simply. And related thereto were the people whose national anthem was, "Don't spit on me, Hubert, until I'm back home." Merely peel yourself from yourself indeed. And now a travel note. A serious man is already halfway home. This does not take into account the question of such a home's desirability. When confronted by gobbledygook, one man would console himself by thinking, "Well, better than no gook at all." All maps are inventions, at best, ad hoc contrivances. To ever achieve a new life, you must discover how to internally separate yourself from the rest of the herd. A dialogue of interest and considerations. Does life have feelings? Certainly. Does life have feelings for man? It doesn't matter whether it does or not, as long as you have feelings for life. For a few, awareness of one's captivity can be a liberating experience. And finally, another example of it takes two to tango in any situation. Pornography is not simply in the eye of the beholder, but also in the other hand from the one holding that being beheld. And I repeat, for a few, awareness of one's captivity can be a liberating experience. Try and consider point blank. Right in the face of your mind, what every philosophical, religious, and mystical attempt is, has been, and at a lower level, the kinds of curiosities, the kinds of uncertainties that periodically flow through the minds of everyone else. What would you do? Or what would you think if we had a situation, if I said there was a planet somewhere and we could picture a group of people who had two eyes, had the kind of sight we do, but then I said, since it was a science fiction tale, and it certainly could be possible, that on this planet, the environment, their wiring was such that there was the possibility in the creatures of having a kind of four-dimensional sight, that they in fact had the ability to see in another depth. What if that nascent or that potential ability was there in everyone? It was not activated, but the potential was there. And if they had any sort of intelligence and consciousness resembling ours, what would that do? What could that possibly do to such creatures that within them? Now imagine that they are, for all intents and purposes, the same as us intellectually, consciously. But that they are seeing in the same way we are, three-dimensional, binaural sight, but that they actually have the ability, the capacity, the latent capacity to see four-dimensionally. Don't ask me how, just imagine it. And you must take into consideration how visual we are, how important it is, and etc. What if we had creatures? What would you think of them? What would you make of it? What could you surmise about their life? What might be interesting aspects of their existence that they're all walking around, and latent within them is the possibility of adding a whole nother dimension to their sight? But that as a race of creatures, they're not aware of it. It's not activated. What might that do? Anything? Can anybody even conceive of the possibility? Can you try and apply it to yourself, to man, and imagine what would it do? I was going to make this a game show, but I don't have any down prizes, so screw it. I'm going to go ahead and answer it for you. At least someone actually answer it and then expect a prize. Well, in case you guessed it, here's your prize. My best wishes. Either that or a piece of penny bubble gum, whichever you consider to be of greater value. I assume that you, I know you do, consider that that was some metaphor having to do with man. That is the nature of everything flowing out of man's mind that does not seem to have a specific purpose. That is, all the technology, all of the physical changes, all of the material products that you can see that are a result of man's thinking. So just discount all of that. Set it aside, and then imagine everything else. And I just picked out the obvious ones as always, religion and philosophy. Really, religion covers it for those of you that by now are no longer tripped up and think this is an attack on religion. Religion done an admirable job for what it does. That is, it does what it's supposed to do. It's not admirable or unadmirable. It just does it. But everything else that are products of man's thinking, the arts, well, if you consider the arts, religion, and philosophy. That about covers. In other words, things of no real practical use in the sense of survival. They are of no practical value. They are not necessary. All of those, and they seem to be at oft times not only diverse and separate, such as religion and philosophy, but it oftentimes very commonly seen as being in an adversarial relationship, that religion and philosophy are two different things, that most philosophers are agnostics or atheists and etc., and that the arts are by and large peopled by the unreligious. It's all a product of the same thing, and that is the fact that every ordinarily wired up, physically healthy person on this planet is calling themselves conscious, whereas they could be conscious in a different way and their whole life would change. If everyone can be conscious in a different way instantly, but if you could hold it, everyone's life, no one, put it to you a better way, no one could live the life they're leading now. Not one person, all the way from presidents to popes to you. If you could be conscious like you can be right this second, and if you had the ability to hold it, no one doing that, no one could live the life they lead. Now, if that be a fact, which it be a fact, even without people being aware of it, now consider the possibilities of how that affects people. Probably take more than a few seconds of me pausing. It results in almost every complaint, almost every criticism that men have against each other and against themselves. All feelings of guilt, all feelings of criticism and condemnation of other people, all of the non-physical, that is the non-survival basis of conflict that men have. Theoretical conflicts, religious, political conflicts. Not actually fighting over a water hole. Not actually fighting over food somewhere. But if they're fighting over those things that are not absolutely survival based, there's a way in which to see it that is quite proper, that it's all a result of the fact that people have a latent capacity that they are not exercising. The way in which you can be, that you can shift your state of internal awareness right this second just by trying to, if you held that, if a man could hold that, an ordinary person, anybody, let me tell you some of the things that would happen. You would have no fear. You'd have, instead of me starting this, think of every admirable description, every honorable description that ordinary people institutionally and, well, institutionally is the base of all of it with ordinary people, but consider all the descriptions of what a real Jew would be, a real Muslim, a real Christian, etc. Or just consider from a non-clerical view, a humanist's or a philosopher's conception of what would be the wise man, what would be a splendid man, what would be an honest, upright, etc. What would be damn near Superman? It would be a person that the attributes that they would give to such a man, those would be natural if you could hold your consciousness in that unnatural state continually. You would naturally be what Christians say a man should be and can't be. They would be proved to be liars. They would be proved incorrect, because even the one saying, well, it's not possible, no one can be Christ but Christ, or Muslims saying no one can be replace Muhammad, or you know how it goes. They say that the ideas of being a superior person in that sense, not somebody, we're not speaking about the physical realm, of course, we're not talking about someone who is simply rich or someone who is physically powerful in some position. The idea that there is some additional worth, potential in man, or some potential in man, but it's internal. His spiritual worth, his intellectual worth, commonly referred to, as you know, as his spiritual worth in some way. They say, once institutionally, once some religion, some philosophical system, as primarily religions, as you know, has offered a model of man, that a true Jew, let's say, would be somebody that could live absolutely by the Ten Commandments. Whatever the standard is, it doesn't matter. All the standards amount to the same thing, all the different religions. And those actively supporting, promoting such religions, they all state, the institution of the religion states, that no one can achieve it. All you can do is aspire to it. Which is true under ordinary conditions, but if a man held his consciousness in that alternative, in that additional way that is possible, it's not mysterious, it's not hocus pocus, it's not drug induced, it's not your imagination, you can do it right this second. What it amounts to, it seems to clear out the mind, it seems to stop. Of course, with ordinary people, when they try it, for the first time they realize that this flow through this head, this great activity, can be stopped momentarily. It happens with people, but they give no note to it. But then ordinary people find out you can stop it. To what avail, they don't know, and it takes effort. But if they just did that, all I was pointing out in this sense is that the very things that people believe are not possible would be possible. It would take no effort after that. All of the so-called shortcomings and sins of man are not possible. again, I repeat, we're talking about above the survival level, because at the survival level, there are no sins. You would kill to eat, and that's it, if you had to. But above that level, in the area of singular demand, the all of that which is a product of his thinking, of his consciousness, if a man put himself and could hold that other state of consciousness that is continually, always, instantly available through his own effort, and he held it, then all of the so-called sins, all the complaints that men have historically and institutionally had against themselves, you simply could not do it. You would not do it. It would become, wouldn't even cross your mind. It would be a world without any complaint. Or from ordinary people's view, it would probably strike them more if I said it'd be a world without sin. It wouldn't be possible for the individual. Why do not people do it then, if it is true? Can you see a reason? Is there anything to lead a reasonable person to believe that life wants men to do it? If we've got the ability to do it and men do not do it, does that give any sort of hint? Assuming that you are a bit more intellectually sophisticated than to believe that we're still living out some curse, and that there is some force extraneous to this system that has it in for us as of getting even with us or making us pay off some debt. Assuming you're past that, then consider, ask yourself, why would it be that we've got this ability, speaking collectively of man, we've got this ability that if it were exercised, would stop all complaints that men have about themselves and each other. That if everyone did it, you would have no complaint with anyone else in the world. I might point out your physical social contact would be greatly reduced. Because there is not only the physical herd instinct that holds men together the same as wolves and elephants, but there is also a non-physical herd instinct that holds men together. I'm going ahead and describe it this way. It could be described as a non-understood mutual, let me see, a mutual, non-describable, misunderstood lack of full operational capacity. The point being, people are held together sexually, socially, at the same kind of level, that's no big deal, that animals are. People like to be around other people at a physical level. Whether you're having actual sexual contact or even physical contact, at times people like to be in crowds. You like to be around other humans, most people. But I'm telling you, beyond that level, there is something else. That's enough to hold people together. If we were just at that level, we would be probably physically not unlike we are now, the same kinds of bunches and groups. But there is something else holding men together, and that is a kind of non-physical, non-sexual, but non-physical herd instinct. And it's here. And I could describe it in numerous ways, but since I made up that one on the spot, based upon what we're talking about tonight, it would be, my description, I'll see if I can straighten it out, would be like, ordinary people are all aware of the fact, that's not true. I'm trying to keep from saying unconsciously, because that throws ordinary people, because they think they know what it means. It is a non-aware awareness in all humans that they are lacking something. And in religion, of course, the answer is normally or nominally provided. And people, by and large, will accept somebody's explanation as to why they seem upset or why they are not absolutely satisfied with life. Sometimes they'll take a psychological explanation. What I'm trying to tell you is it's as though all civilized people in a way that they cannot express, because they would have to be conscious in a different way than the way I'm discussing. But it's as though all these creatures, how about this? All the creatures on that planet I made up that were more or less like us, except had the ability, the capacity, which was unrealized, the capacity to see in four dimensions. And I said that they all had it. It would be like they were held together in a non-physical herd instinct way, non-physically speaking. They were held together by the common reality. We'll drop awareness and all that stuff. Because, you know, I'm trying to explain something that can't literally be explained. But it would be as though they were being held together by the reality of the fact that they in common all shared an unrealized capacity. The reality that they all had the capacity to see in four dimensions, and yet they did not exercise it. The reality of that, the reality of that held them together. All right, how about this? Picture a whole planet of creatures who are easily frightened, like children, like deer. And instead of this additional capacity, let's change it allegorically into that this turns into a type of fright for which they have no name. They're just edgy. They're uneasy in a certain way that is non-physical. No one knows what it is, but they're all that way. You know how deer and animals that are way down on the food chain are very alert, always looking, rabbits, constantly like this, always on edge. Apparently from a human's view, you'd think, boy, you know, I'd be stressed out if I was a bunny. know, or a bird, you can't ever stop, you know. You got to be looking. Move that allegorically. Use that as my description of an executed capacity in these creatures. It is then as though they're all being held together in a non-physical herd way, that they're all drawn to be together because they all have this, and they don't know why, but it seems as though if you're around a whole bunch of creatures, everybody going, just seem like it's your kind of creatures, my kind of guys. I don't really want to say much more about it, but surely you get the idea that if you can by now stretch your allegorical sight and your metaphorical understanding enough, you can make sense out of that, that it happens in its own way with humans here on Earth in other ways, in other manners. But it is as though that there is a kind of fright, a kind of edginess, and nobody's really sure what. And it helps hold people together. How else do you explain people gathering in large groups consistently for what is stated to be the highest possible purposes? And by this, religion is the only thing that fits the bill. And they have been doing it for thousands of years, and yet you look at what it's doing, and it is a collection. Albeit, you look down, and it is in structures, physical structures, that are unsurpassed on this planet for their beauty. They just, some of them will take your breath away. And all of the emblems, the icons, the paintings, the music inside these structures, and their stated purpose is the absolute highest that can be expressed by men, whether you agree with the particular dogma of any specific religion. It is, in general, the highest aspirations. The highest model of man are presented there, and so you look and you think, how impressive, until you get down closer and get into it, and it's a gathering. You would think, once you get an idea of what they're talking about, what's going on here, you think, wait a minute, this is somewhat curious that here, say you're a visitor from another planet, and there it is, a great cathedral, and the music, they're playing Bach, and the choir singing, and the light coming through the stained glass windows, and the high vaults, and you get down close, and it turns out, though, from one view, it's a gathering of the extremely stupid. Does it make any sense? From one view, that here it is, I would suggest to you, submit to you, that if you were a kind of traveler from another world and you had some experience and genetic familiarity or something in common with men, and that you started circling around the planet and you were hovering up there flying in some mystical way, and you picked out what would be the most impressive looking structures. And I'd suggest if they were in any way human, of course they'd have to be human and a little superhuman to be able to engage in such travel, that they would bypass all the great office buildings. They might take a glance at them, but you would finally end up above religious services, taking everything in consideration, that the big ones, they have drawn in all of the arts. They've got painting, they've got music, they've got architecture. There is a quietness to it. You go into a big cathedral during Mass or any good temple or mosque when it's everything is right on schedule and the people are there, so to speak, of their own free will. They come there. There is a feeling to it that is very uncommon on this planet, whether you see it as singular or not. And it's not always, but at any particular moment you could be inside of a cathedral somewhere where there is a religious service going on, and you all know this. It doesn't have to be your religion. But when it is, everything is just right, you do know that the experience, the feel there. You can't be there alone, by the way, in case you never thought about that. You can't walk in Notre Dame and sit there alone. I don't care, the sun shining through, an organist is playing some music, and you sit there by yourself, you'll never get it. Think about that. But when you're there, if you just walked in and you sit in the middle, it is an extremely uncommon experience. There's nowhere on this planet that has that kind of, I'm not trying to make any more out of it than there is, but there is more to it than normally happens amongst crowds of people. It's not the same as a football game. And it's not just the noise or the drinking. It's not the same as attending a movie. When it's right and you're there, you know that there is a kind of feeling, a kind of peace. There's just a feeling that is very uncommon on this planet. So there you are, this traveler, and you, say you're invisible. So you hover over and you think, well, now that's interesting. You fly around the planet right quick and you think, well, that's more interesting than anything I see. And so you fly down invisibly and you fall right in the middle of the cathedral. And you sit there and you listen to them talk for a little while. And better yet, that you're able to perceive the thinking of those around you. You would momentarily, I don't know what people from other planets would do, but you'd think, you know, I've fallen into a bad cartoon. Because at first you'd think, I have found what must be the center, this must be central station for their evolution. This must be the center of their planet, these kind of places. Of course, you'd seen a bunch of them, but you would think, well, this must be the primary outlet. This is where people go when they really want to be charged up. This is where their evolution, it's like their power station. Maybe it's where they go to get supercharged. And so you float down in there invisibly and get there, and you sit there for, it wouldn't take but a few seconds, and it would make no sense whatsoever. That everything observable leads you to believe that it was what I described that would be the primary centers of their continuing growth and development. And it all felt right, it sounded right, it looked right, until you got down there in it and you think, it's a convention of idiots. These places must be where they, but it would make no sense. That everything that you observed would tell you that this is the place, if you were a visitor and looking for what is going on, where will I get an idea of where humans are going, where they are actively evolving? And that would be it. And yet you'd sit down, get there in the middle of them, and listen, especially as I said, be able to perceive what people were thinking. Those in there, apparently, deeply engrossed, those apparently actively involved with whatever it is that's going on, you think I've been fooled. There's something completely strange because it appears to be one thing, but from another view, after I'm here, it apparently maybe is some kind of warehousing for the dunces of the planet. You know, rather than this being where the most active evolutionary instruction and endeavors are going on, which up to that point, the man, this traveler, had no doubt. He'd just take a quick glance all around the planet and see stadiums, football games, and this and that, but he would immediately pick them out. Wouldn't take but a few circles around the planet, flying around looking this. And so he'd get into one, but then he would think, how confused, how could I have been so misled that this, but I had no doubt that I was in the right place to see the front ranks, the most active place where their evolution is being discussed, being attempted. They're passing along information from those a little. Anyway, it would appear to be the power sources, the most active centers of their evolution, and they get together periodically to reinforce, to pass along information, to collectively struggle forward, and yet you fall down the middle of it and get into the internal area, get into the area of the intellect, of what they're saying and what they're thinking. And you think, well, it's just the opposite. Where are those evolving? Because this, by all intents, everything that he knew from this universe, that is where it should be. And yet he got there, and it appeared to be kindergarten. We're a holding pen for idiots, for the stupid, for the retarded of the planet. So there my traveler would be, and thinking, well, if this is not where they are, where are they? Of course, he was that good. I'll go ahead and answer. Where they are is in a few people's heads, because there is no where they are. There is no R. You cannot look out on the planet and find an R. If you look for where they are, you'll be looking forever. And if you look for where they are, you'll never do anything yourself, because you always think, well, there's something missing, or if I can find where they are or where it is, I'll be in business. But where does that end up? You end up in a collection, in some room somewhere, in a church, in a meeting hall, under a tree with another group of people. And everybody states, well, I'm a little upset, I'm a little disturbed, I'm interested in so-and-so, and they all agree, and then they all look at each other like, well, what do we do? Of course, usually somebody says, well, let's take up a collection, and I'll be in charge of the finances. And that usually gets it going. I started to say that was a joke, but that wasn't a joke. Yeah, it was. That's all. You can patch together You can do something with a 45-minute tape sooner or later, can't you?